The world has officially entered into a fifth age of fighter plane design, and the leap in technology between fourth and fifth generation fighters is so steep that any adversary that isn't able to keep up risks losing an air war before it even begins. Make no mistake, fourth gen fighters and even 4.5 gen fighters are no longer thought of as survivable platforms in any future great power conflict, meaning only one thing. If a nation wants to fight and win a next generation war, it needs to field the next generation aircraft. Three nations have currently developed fifth-generation fighters to meet this critical need for a survivable fighter platform. Although of those three nations, only America has actually reached initial operational capability in any significant numbers. China's J-20 stealth fighter is not only widely regarded as a poor man's fifth-gen fighter, but it's only active in extremely small numbers. Between 1 to 2 dozen aircraft are currently cleared for combat. Russia's Su-57 is the nation's entry into the fifth-gen fighter game, and it's a very impressive showing for a nation building its first true stealth aircraft. The origins of the fighter hail back to the waning years of the Cold War, when Russia, much as the United States, recognized the need for a next-gen fighter that could survive an increasingly dangerous anti-air environment. Stealth would have to be a critical feature of this new fighter, but it would also have to have a considerable ground attack capability. In short, this fighter would have to be a multi-role platform, much like America's F-22 would end up being. Development of a new fighter, however, was seriously slowed by the collapse of the Soviet Union. With a lack of funding, the program waned for years until it was resurrected in the late 1990s. It would take until 2004 for a conceptual design to be approved by the new Russian Defense Ministry, and the government funding began in earnest the next year. Budget woes were still abundant, though, for the Russian government, and thus it was decided to invite India into the development program as a partner. With India shouldering half the cost of the development program and committing to buying 214 of the planes, Russia was well on its way to developing a competitor against America's own fifth-gen fighters. As the years passed, though, the Indian government began to lose faith in the Russian design. In 2012, it decreased its plane purchases from 214 to just 144. As the American F-35 neared completion and public demonstrations of its capabilities began to take place, India lost even more faith in the Su-57, and in 2018, the nation scored a crippling blow against the Russian fifth-gen fighter program by leaving the agreement altogether. The Su-57's status was thrown into limbo after India's withdrawal of billions in capital. It would quickly become clear that Russia would not be able to afford a plane on its own. Soon, it was reported that Russia would not order more than a few demonstration models of the aircraft, and it looked as if the Russian Air Forces would be left vulnerable against America's fifth-gen fighters. Priorities were quickly shifted to developing the cheaper S-500 anti-air system as a stopgap measure to try to fend off the F-35 and F-22. Then, Russia got some unexpected help, courtesy of the American President and Senate. After Turkey purchased several S-400 anti-air units from Russia, America's President Trump and the U.S. Senate agreed to throw Turkey out of the F-35 development deal. Even though it had been a key partner in the program and even maintained several key component production facilities, cut off from the F-35, Turkey soon turned to Russia and expressed interest in purchasing the Su-57, with the goal of buying around 100 of the jets. The promise of such a massive infusion of capital into the nearly dead Su-57 program quickly brought it back to life. And today, the Su-57 is not only poised for international sale, but with enough profit from the sales could very well end up being purchased in significant numbers by Russia. Right now, though, the Russian Air Force only operates a few token demonstration models which have been dispatched to Syria in order to generate interest from potential international buyers. The future of the Su-57 completely depends on if nations such as Turkey will end up buying the jet, as at the moment, Russia is still too cash-strapped to afford it on its own. The F-35 has its origins with the Joint Strike Fighter program, itself a merger of other fighter programs across the 1980s and 90s. Due to the high costs and logistical problems of operating air fleets made up of different models of aircraft, the U.S. government sought an easy solution: have one fighter aircraft that can do nearly all the jobs. This would not only result in reduced cost, as more units would be built over the life of the aircraft, but would greatly reduce logistical issues, as maintenance personnel no longer had to train on or store parts for multiple aircraft models. One plane that could do it all was both an operational and financial dream. The only people not quite on board with the JSF bandwagon, though, was the Air Force, which recognized that building a jack-of-all-trades aircraft meant that it would ultimately not excel in any one particular role. Prudently, the Air Force thus pushed Congress to continue funding the development of what would become the F-22 Raptor. While the other services would fly a do-everything budget-friendly plane, the U.S. Air Force demanded a fighter so advanced no foe could possibly approach its capabilities. While the F-35 would become an extremely capable aircraft, the F-22 would end up the world's most lethal aircraft. Ultimately, though, this would also lead to the F-22's downfall. Echoing the troubles of the U.S. Navy's Seawolf submarine class, the F-22 was so advanced and so expensive that there simply existed no realistic need for such a formidable aircraft. At between $140 to $180 million per unit, the F-22 may still be the deadliest aircraft in the sky, but it's also the most expensive, and Congress quickly decided that there existed no air threat in the world at the moment worthy of that hefty investment. Thus, the Air Force was allowed to order just shy of 200 F-22s, but would have to rely on the F-35 as its workhorse just like the other services. The F-35 quickly became the most controversial and expensive weapons program of all time. While the plane is extremely capable, it continues to showcase several serious problems even over a year after entering full-scale production. The most persistent issue, perhaps, is the fact that even though the F-35 is meant to also be a ground attack aircraft, its main gun, a 25mm cannon, can't shoot straight. That would, without a doubt, be of some concern for troops on the ground requiring very close air support. Despite ongoing issues, though, the F-35 is without a doubt an extremely capable and dangerous aircraft. In numerous war games against American and European aircraft, the F-35 has resoundingly defeated all enemy threats, and the only time the aircraft took significant losses was when artificially forced by the rules of the war game into combat scenarios at extremely close ranges. When allowed to operate as it would naturally operate, though, the F-35 is a lethal killer, knocking 4th and 4.5th gen fighters out of the sky long before they even realize it's there. So, which is the better aircraft, the Su-57 or the F-35? The answer is, as it usually is, not a simple one. First, it's important to understand the design philosophies behind both aircraft. The Su-57 was designed to be a premier air superiority and ground attack aircraft, but it was not designed to be a workhorse aircraft. Due to Russia's budget problems, the nation would never be able to field it in large enough numbers to fully replace their air fleet with Su-57s. Thus, it was meant to act as a force multiplier supporting Russia's 4th and 4.5th gen aircraft. The F-35, by comparison, was meant to replace nearly all of the U.S. fighter and ground attack fleet, which meant that serious compromises had to be made to accommodate such a wide variety of roles. On paper, the F-35's performance is thus very often greatly outclassed by the Su-57, which have led many to believe the Su-57 to be the superior plane. Because the Su-57 was never planned to be bought in great numbers, the aircraft could be more expensive than an F-35 and thus pack in more design features. The F-35 is equipped with only a single engine versus the Su-57's two engines, which meant that the Su-57 has a higher service ceiling of nearly 66,000 feet versus the F-35's 50,000 feet, and that it can fly faster at 1,616 miles per hour versus the F-35's 1,199 miles per hour. Physically larger than the F-35, the Su-57 is 72 feet long versus 50 feet, and has a width of 47 feet versus 35 feet, and has an empty weight of 40,786 pounds versus the F-35's 29,002 pounds. This means that the Su-57 can fly further than the F-35, with a range of 3,107 miles versus 1,379 miles. The larger size allows the Su-57 to carry more weapons, featuring up to 8 weapon hardpoints versus the 4 of the F-35 in its internal weapon base, though both aircraft can carry weapons on their wings in a non-stealthy configuration. On day one of war, both aircrafts would carry their weapons internally, but once air superiority has been established, weapons can be attached to external hardpoints, though the Su-57 will always be able to carry more ordnance given its larger size. Despite the Su-57's two engines, the Raptor engine is not only more efficient, but allows the plane to supercruise or fly at supersonic speed without the use of afterburners. Afterburners, in essence, destroy a plane's ability to fly stealthily, and while the Su-57 has greater speed, it must make use of afterburners in order to fly at supersonic speeds. This is because the aircraft is still using 4th-gen engines. Russia has not successfully developed the 5th-generation engine it needs to achieve supercruise capabilities. Currently, Russia's Izdela 30 engine is still undergoing flight testing and is not believed to be operational anytime before 2025. This is of little surprise to foreign observers, as the United States has always maintained a technological edge in engine technology. The inability to supercruise and use of old inferior engines means that the Su-57 is at a serious disadvantage against a squadron of Raptors. Russian Su-57 pilots would either have to be pre-positioned along the Raptor's flight path or use afterburners for a successful intercept. The first choice would require perfect intelligence on the American planes and their mission, and a tactical near impossibility, and the second choice would nullify the Su-57's stealth, and to make them easy pickings for a long-range air attack by the stealthy Raptors. Where the Su-57 shines, though, is in dogfight scenarios, as it has incredible agility and maneuverability versus the F-35. If forced into a close-quarters fight, the F-35 would be dominated by a Su-57 and have little hope for survival. With the F-35's slower speed, if pursued by a Su-57, the F-35 would almost certainly be caught and destroyed. But when it comes to fifth generation, though, stealth is what matters most after engines, and here the F-35 stands head and shoulders above the Su-57. Despite a great deal of propaganda from the Russian Defense Ministry, the most telling assessment of the Su-57's real stealth signature comes from the fact that Indian withdrawal from the program was largely due to serious concerns about poor stealth engineering. In a rare moment of candor, the Russian news outfit Moskovsky Komsomolets Online, a former arm of the Communist Youth News Network, said that the Su-57 could not be called a fifth-generation fighter due to its poor low observation capabilities. Indian military sources expected that their version of the Su-57 would have a head-on radar cross-section of half a square meter, which is significantly worse than the F-35's cross-section of 0.001 meters or the F-22's cross-section of 0.0001 square meters. In essence, a Su-57's head-on radar cross-section is the size of a truck tire, while the F-35's cross-section is the size of a golf ball, and the F-22 is that of a marble. With such dramatically poor stealth features, the Su-57 would not fare very well in a head-on long-range engagement against an F-35, although in a dogfight scenario, the Su-57 would dominate. Unfortunately, the last dogfight the world ever witnessed happened toward the end of 1988, and given the state of today's long-range sensors and missile systems, no pilot in the world believes a dogfight will happen anytime again soon. Ultimately, which aircraft is better depends on the scenario. In most circumstances, the F-35 is the better aircraft, not necessarily because it's physically superior, but rather because it's far better at its job than the Su-57. In a traditional dogfight, though, the Su-57 continues to give Russia the advantage it has traditionally enjoyed in close-quarters fighting. However, the real testament to which is the better aircraft may come from the fact that over 400 Raptors have already been built, while only 11 Su-57s are currently flying. Want to see more awesome videos? Why not tell us what you think is the best now? Check out this video here, then check out this other one over here, and let us know which you enjoyed the best. Don't wait, click now!